Hi, this is Raphael, the creator of Cobalt Strike. In this video, I'd like to demonstrate Cobalt Strike's new ability to command and control its beacon payload over DNS. Beacon is a Cobalt Strike payload for red team operations. Like any other RAT, Beacon can execute commands, log keystrokes, download and upload files, and you may also use it to spawn an interpreter session if you need it as well. What makes Beacon different from other remote administration tools is it uses asynchronous communication, meaning rather than always being connected to the attacker, the payload checks in, downloads tasks, and executes them. And as of the latest Cobalt Strike release, Beacon now has the ability to download tasks over HTTP or DNS. Here's what the asynchronous communication process looks like. Once Beacon is staged, those are steps one and step two, Beacon then goes into a mode where it queries you, the attacker, checking if a task is available. And the DNS beacon does this using, go figure, the DNS protocol. It makes an A record request for an attacker-controlled domain, and if there's no tasking, the DNS server says, hey, there's nothing for you to do. Go back to sleep. And the agent goes back to sleep. If there is a task, though, the compromised host running Beacon will then connect to you, downloads tasks, and execute them. And again, this is something Beacon has always done. And in the past, the connection process would happen over HTTP, but in this video, you now have the option of getting tasks over DNS as well. The ability to communicate over DNS, though, is not complete without the ability to stage a payload over DNS. And what do I mean by that? In the Metasploit framework, payloads are staged, meaning they are delivered in parts. When I attack a host, for example, the browser exploit, the victim will download my attack, and if it's successful, they will start executing a small piece of code called a stager, or stage one. That little piece of code will connect back to me, the attacker, download the second stage, and execute it. Okay, that's all there is to it. Now, if I can download the payload over HTTP, then I probably don't need the ability to communicate over DNS, right? So in my mind, it's really important that this payload staging process can happen over DNS, meaning victim opens up my attack package or visits my malicious website, and once the attack is successful, they actually connect back to me and download the rest of the payload, Beacon, over DNS. And that's possible to do now. And I'm going to show you that in our demonstration as well. To communicate over DNS, we first have to set up some DNS records. I own the domain losenolove.com. Earlier, I created an A record for a node in Amazon's Elastic Computing Cloud that's running Cobalt Strike. This domain is malwarec2.losenolove.com. Scrolling down a little bit, I also created name server records for three subdomains that will use our EC2 Cobalt Strike node as their authoritative name server. And that's freepicks.losenolove.com, game.losenolove.com, and profiles.losenolove.com. Whenever anybody on the internet makes a request for any string, .freepicks.losenolove.com, my Cobalt Strike system, malwarec2.losenolove.com, will respond to that request. So now that we've got the DNS records set up, let's go take a look at Cobalt Strike. Here I am in Cobalt Strike. To set up Beacon, we're going to have to create a listener. So let's go to Cobalt Strike, listeners, and let's go ahead and press add, and let's create a listener called Beacon Demo. Now let's go ahead and choose the payload, and we're going to choose Cobalt Strike's DNS beacon, okay? Windows beacon DNS reverse HTTP. The reverse HTTP means the default way to stage this payload is over HTTP. Let's put in the port 80, and that's for the web server for staging beacon if we choose to stage it that way. And let's press save. Beacon is now going to ask me which domains it should try to beacon back to. Again, because this is DNS beacon, the actual domains must be domains that Cobalt Strike is authoritative for. So we're going to put in profiles.losenolove.com, game.losenolove.com, and freepicks.losenolove.com. Let's press OK, and we now have a beacon listener. Now, let's go ahead and set up an attack. I'm going to use attacks web drive-by signed applet attack for Cobalt Strike's Java signed applet. Let's go ahead and click on that. And one of the things we have to do to use this attack is create a Java listener. So let me do that real quick. I'll just call this Java interpreter. And let's do port 8989. And let's select the Win32 listener. You can see we've got beacon demo, the listener we defined, but we also have beacon demo over DNS. And what this DNS option means is that Cobalt Strike should attempt to stage beacon over DNS. The default way would actually have beacon connect to us, or have the compromised system connect to us and download beacon over HTTP. But for this demo, we're all about DNS, so let's do beacon demo DNS. Let's press launch, and we now have a Java signed applet attack running. Let's go over to our victim system. Here I am in Windows 7. First thing I'm going to do is connect over Internet Explorer and connect to our Java signed applet attack. Here we're being prompted and asked if we want to run this Java application. Now, before I do that, let's go ahead and open up Wireshark, and let's go ahead and press Capture, Restart. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead and press Run, and this system, this Windows 7 system, will be compromised, and its next step will be to download Beacon over DNS and inject it into memory. Let's press Run. So I press Run. And you can see now a bunch of DNS TXT record requests are happening, okay? We can see oca.stage.something.profiles.losenolove.com, so on and so forth. The beacon payload, when it's encoded as alphanumeric shellcode, it's about, I want to say, 160, 170 kilobytes. And we're staging it 255 bytes at a time as DNS TXT records using the resolver built into Windows. So we can see the staging process is still happening, although it's almost complete. You can see that sometimes requests are repeating themselves because for whatever reason, our DNS traffic is being throttled. Know that a lot of care, love, and design went into making Beacon, even its stager written in assembler, resilient to these situations so that it will actually download this large payload and inject it into memory and get it intact. If you want to see what one of these requests look like, here's the request. Here you can see the alpha numeric shellcode, 255 bytes of it, and each of these replies looks pretty similar, so nothing too special there. One thing I'd like to point out, this is the staging process. It's very noisy. I mean, it's a lot of packets. It's about 1,000 DNS requests, okay, to stage beacon over DNS. Use the DNS stager only if you feel that you don't have any other option, okay? I wouldn't use it as your default stager. As you can see, it takes longer than an HTTP GET request, and it generates more noise on the wire. On the flip side, if DNS is your only way out of a network, you now have an option to get out, and that's very valuable too. So with that, we'll just go ahead and restart this, and let's go ahead and close Internet Explorer. We don't need it anymore. And let's go ahead and take a look at things from the perspective of Cobalt Strike. Here I am, back in Cobalt Strike. If I go to View Beacons, I can see that 38 seconds ago, somebody checked in, meaning something is running on a system somewhere, but because the system has not actually communicated with me, I don't know anything about it, okay? So what we need to do is we need to task this agent so that next time it checks in with us, it will actually communicate metadata about the compromised system and plus carry out our orders. So what I'm going to do is highlight this line, press interact. Now, since this is beacon, just like normal, it will by default communicate over HTTP. But I can change that. I can type mode DNS to tell beacon that it should now use DNS to download taskings and send output and communicate metadata. Now, let's type help and see what we can do. You can see that beacon is a normal remote administration tool. I can tell it to execute a command. I can have it display a message on the desktop. Kai, you are owned. And you know, I can do all kinds of cool things with it. And for the sake of our demos, I can even change the sleep time. We'll make it 20 seconds. Now, the host called back. Okay, so you can see that it called back and it downloaded all of our taskings. And again, keep in mind, DNS is not a silver bullet for an attacker. It took about 5.5 seconds to actually send 304 bytes to the target. But you can see that we got our output back, and presumably, the sleep time for the agent was changed 20 seconds, and our target has a "Hi, your own" message box on their desktop. If we go to the Beacons tab, you can see that we actually have some metadata about the host as well. We know the internal IP address, but not the external, because nobody ever communicated with us directly. We know the user, the computer, the process ID, and the last check-in time. And you can also see we've got a nifty monitor in our Cobalt Strike display. Now, let's go over to the Windows 7 system and see what this looks like from the perspective of the target. Here I am in Windows 7 again, and let's go ahead and take a look at what happened. You can see that Beacon made its DNS request to see if anything was happening via the domains we embedded into it. And earlier, nothing, go back to sleep. And about a minute later, so you can see the time right here, 60 seconds approximately, we can see a different DNS response came back, and Beacon went to work downloading metadata, embedding that data in the actual host name it's requesting. Now, even if somebody intercepted this traffic, it's actually encrypted. The data itself is actually encrypted with a key that's embedded into the beacon payload. So, you know, it makes it a bit harder to figure out what's going on. So you can see different kinds of requests happening to actually download and carry out our taskings. The good news is that once Beacon is staged, whether it happened over HTTP or over DNS, once it's staged, it's far less chatty. It periodically makes an A record request to check for tasks. And if it's downloading information, then it makes a series of A record requests to us, the attacker, or through the DNS system, excuse me, it doesn't talk to us directly. It makes a series of A record requests to try to build up its taskings, and it decrypts it and executes it. So that's a beacon over DNS and what it looks like. And you can see there's our your own message from earlier. Okay, so you saw things from the victim perspective. One last demo I'd like to show you is the ability to use beacon to stage a payload. So let's go ahead and close that tab and reopen it. So we got some metadata in there. Let's right click, go to spawn. Let's press add, and let's create a Windows Meterpreter listener, port 443. And we'll use Windows Meterpreter reverse HTTPS. Hit save. We now have a Windows Meterpreter listener. Let's hit choose. And next time beacon calls home, it will over DNS inject the stager for Meterpreter reverse HTTPS and yield for us a Meterpreter session. So just give that a moment. There you go. You can see that the host called home. It downloaded its tasking, and this time about 3 seconds. And when we're successful, we will actually end up with a Meterpreter session and give it a minute to finish staging. And there we go. So that's an example of how beacon can act as a lifeline to your target's network. So with that, my main goal here today was to demonstrate using beacon to control a host over DNS and to stage the beacon payload over DNS. This feature is available in the latest release of Cobalt Strike, which is available at www.advancedpentest.com. A 21-day trial is available as well. I highly encourage you to check it out. This is a pretty neat payload. And with that, good luck and happy hacking.